Father, even now as we open your word together, we ask of you that you would come in the power of your spirit and bless us, that you would strengthen us, that you would clarify for us the word from heaven, that we may leave here this evening transformed by this encounter. Please bring hope to hopeless hearts, and bring healing to hurting hearts, and bring strength to fainting hearts, and cause us, O God, to receive your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Disconnected. We have come to live at a time when everything seemed to be about connection. You cannot get anything done if you're not connected. Back in the day, before we got into this network society, we used to talk about connection in relationship to who you are connected to. So we would say, you can't get anything done if you are not well connected. But today, we've come to live at a time when the word connection evokes many other images in our minds. When we think of connection, immediately we go back to the consequence of rupture. Back in the early days, the means of holding things together was the rope. And if the rope broke, as a farmer, the animal was gone. If the rope broke, as a construction worker, whatever you had tied down was gone. If the rope broke, danger would be in the air. Well, for us to get light, for us to operate our equipment, we would have to ensure that we keep the plug inserted in the socket. And if there was ever a removal of the plug from the socket, there would be a loss of what?
Power.
And when you have a loss of power, nothing works. Disconnected. We've come to live, however, at a time when technology has taken us to a whole other dimension of what it means to be connected or to be disconnected. I don't know if you can read what's written in the sand, but here's this little girl and what she says. No internet. Send help. We are so plugged in, we are so connected to the technological cycle that if you go someplace and you take out your cell phone or you take out your tablet and there is no reading of an internet signal, it seems as though this society goes into crisis. Send help! No signal. I drive around with my phone all the time, and it is amazing to me how the connection works. You could be at one place, and you have all the bars you need for a conversation. And you turn the corner, you take out that phone, and you look at the signal, and what you've got beside the receiver is an X. No signal. And no matter what price phone you have got, no matter all the fancy equipment in your phone, if you have no signal, that phone is no good for communicating. No signal. Back in the day, when we talked about phones, everybody was talking about this big fat thing you lift it up and you put against your ear. After you heard the bell tones, and you would say, hello. Today, we don't even bother with that. This is not a talk to you generation. This is a text it to me generation. But
But friends, despite all that has happened to enhance human interaction, or so it seemed, despite all that has happened to bridge the gap between man and man, between varied individuals over massive distances, today we sit at a time when humanity is consummately sitting with the head in the hand and the world is in utter frustration. We've come to live at a time when we are, though we seem to be so connected, we are even more disconnected than ever. Amen. You're walking and you are in the mall and you see people and they would bump right into you. They run you over walking. There was a time when we say somebody ran you over, the only thing they could be doing was driving. But robots! We're all traveling in the one car. And in times gone by, if you're in the same vehicle and you're going on a road trip, everybody in the car would be talking together. You'd be sightseeing. Look at that, look at that, look at that, look at that. And you'd be talking. It'd be conversation. Today, here is what? Every man is on his device. Either you are in the taxi, or, you know, the ears are plugged up and you're listening to something. We're all in the same place physically, but we have never been more disconnected. Friend, it seemed to me that we've all come to this massive break. Society is so disconnected, so dysfunctional, and it's like a bridge that has been broken off. I remember back in 2008, that election campaign. I don't know if you remember, but there was this big discussion, you know, about the bridge to nowhere. It is my assessment tonight that humanity is on a rush. Humanity is on a pathway, but it's a bridge to absolutely nowhere. The Russian crunch of life, it seems that we are all pursuing one goal after another. And somehow it seems that even when you have achieved your goals, life does not seem to add up. Mm-hmm. Oh, the rich man, the wise man Solomon says, dies just like the fool. You've labored, you've accumulated, you have bought the home you wanted to buy, you have acquired the possessions you desire. And you said, I have made something of myself. And then you visit the doctor. And he gives you notice. It will all soon belong to somebody else. We were right here a few months ago when I told you of the young man who is a relative of a member of the congregation. And here's the young man. He graduated high school early, mm-hmm. on the accelerated pathway, mm-hmm. got accepted into medical school, and he was doing fantastic, doing very well, acing his courses, all A's. And then came that fateful evening, went on the rooftop, and fell from the roof on his head, accidentally. And now he is laying, unable to change even his clothes himself. Shiver, brain damage. It just seems as though even when we are achieving the things we are setting out to achieve, that the moment you think you're about to triumph, it slips away from you. Joy seems to be just one step ahead, and sorrow just seems to find a way to fall in lockstep with you, uninvited.
But if you keep finding only portions of something, if you keep finding halves and quarters, if you keep finding mismatched pairs of shoes, you know that sometime before there was once more than you are now finding. Is that true? If every time you look, there is not enough to go with what you are discovering, it suggests that something has happened. Are you with me? It suggests that the picture has not always been as it now is. You know that sometime before there was something better. And if you go into a community and all you find are one pair of this shoes, you know, mismatched dress, blouse, shirt, tie, all disconnected, then the conclusion that we draw is that there has been trauma. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. If you go and you find that the houses are all lying on their sides and the roofs are all blown off, you say there's been trauma. Something has happened. As we take a closer look at who we are, it seems clear to me that we were intended for more than we have become. It seemed to me that as I survey humanity, as I look out at life, it seemed to me that things have not worked out the way they were supposed to be. The beautiful sunset, the joyous sunrise, the mass provision of clean, reinvigorating air, of pure, clear, crystal water. The joy of walking in nature just seemed to not jive with the experience of life. You can take a picture, and somebody would say, that place looks like paradise. But no matter what your opinion of what that place looks like, if you get to know the people who live there, they have the same problems you do. Something is wrong. The human body is made up, I'm told, of trillions of cells. Now, cells of the nervous system are called nerve cells or neurons. And they specialize in carrying messages through an electrochemical process. The human brain has approximately 100 billion neurons. So, the general estimate has said for some time, recent research in which they took a brain and sort of made it, using the researcher's own words, into soup. And analyze the neural content suggests that we might be some 14 billion cells short of that 100 billion. But somewhere there, somewhere between 86 and 100 billion neural cells are said to be in the human brain. Now, let me tell you that some of the smallest neurons have cell bodies that are only 4 microns wide. And some of the biggest neurons have cell bodies that are only 100 microns wide. Your body is teeming with message carriers. Are you with me? Your system is able to communicate at 268 miles per hour. Anybody can drive that?
168 miles per hour. So you think it in your mind, I want to go right. And before you even know, you're thinking, I want to go right. The body's turning right. It seemed that we were hardwired for tremendous capacity. The brain represents 3% of the body's weight, but uses 20% of the body's energy. It seems that whoever designed the human body designed it so that the brain would have priority of demand on the energy of the man. Another mystery hidden within our crinkled cortices is that out of all the brain cells, only 10% are neurons. Let's talk now. We just said there are about 86 billion or 100 billion neural cells in the brain, but of all the cells that are in the brain, only 10% are neurons. So this 100 billion that we're talking about, or this 86 billion, depending on which figure you want to take, represents only 10% of the content of the brain. Are you with me? So that 90% of the cells that are there are glial cells. And with all the sophistication of human technology, with all the research that we have conducted, the function of the glial cells remains largely unknown. We have no idea what's going on up there. With the billions of dollars that we have put into the research, into artificial intelligence, we still have no idea how consciousness is constructed. When I look at 10% of the brain being neural cells and 90% being made up of substance and matter that we don't even know what to say about, I am here to say to you tonight that it seemed that man was made for a higher purpose and a higher function and a bigger goal than we have ever conceived. Are you with me?
Yes.
You were designed for something greater.
Amen.
You were not just made to wash pots and pans and drive around sheets of metals called cars and live in stone houses and drink out of a bottle and burp and satisfy yourselves. We were made for something tremendously greater. Bible tells me that God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways. I hear an inspired writer say, higher than the highest human thought can reach is God's ideal for his children. And it seemed to me that God designed man to reach the ideal and the destiny that he created for him. So I can agree with the psalmist. In Psalm 139, come there with me, Psalm 139. I can agree with the psalmist in Psalm 139 and verse 14. What did the psalmist say? I will do what? I will praise thee for what? I am fearfully and what? Wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. We were fearfully and wonderfully made. So I'm going to suggest to you that whatever is the miss with man, it was not in his design. Can I say it again? Whatever was the mess with man, it was not in his design. Though there are those who would think that they can enhance human power by mechanical and bioengineering means. There's a lot of research that has been invested in trying to make the cartoon come to life in reality. Because in the cartoon, from your child, you've been hearing about Superman, right? Superman. And man is earning earnestly trying to transform himself into Superman. He wanna develop X-ray vision so he can see through things. We wanna input the content of Google into the mind. We wanna insert chips into the cranial functions so we can access content without even needing a device, because we ourselves would have become the device. We think that through bioengineering and mechanical engineering, we can improve humanity. But let me tell you something. The report from the Divine Engineering and Construction Department was that when God made man, man was flawless. Are you with me?
Amen.
So I agree with God's assessment. Because in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, the Bible says what? And God said. Who said? God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Man is not an accident. Man was a divine intent. Are you with me? All this design, when you see, after examining the brain, that 10% of it confuses the entire content capacity of human ingenuity. 10% of the human brain is far more complex in its capacity to handle content than the entire storage capacity of all the intelligence services that run human society. One man's brain. 10% of one man's brain. And somebody wants to tell me this evening that we're all accidents.
Yeah.
That nothing and nothing got together and made everything. Somebody wants to tell me that in the tremendous intelligence of their personal analysis of life, that they've come to the conclusion that man is just an evolved monkey.
Not.
Somebody wants to tell me that the Creator is just a stone. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Verse 27, what does the Bible say? So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Man was not made broken. Are you with me? When God made man was perfect. Because in Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, the Divine Engineering Company gave a certified stamp to the finished product. Are you with me this evening? And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was what?
Very
good. There was no flaw in the divine engineering. Are you with me this evening? So when God made man, man was perfect. And even after 6,000 years of sin, man's design far excelled anything that man can conceive. Are you with me this evening? When God made man, he was not broken. He was not made fragmented, damaged, or disjointed. When God made man, he was holy. Come on, somebody. Upright and good. Man was made in the image of God.
Amen.
Man resembled God in character.
Amen.
So how did we end up in the mess that we are in? Let's go to the book of Genesis. Find out how we got into the mess that we are in. Genesis chapter 3. Let's find the source of the mess. Because if it was not in the design, and it was not in the environment, because the Bible says God saw everything that he had made, and it was good. Oh, my friends, our first parents couldn't blame
the environment for their problems. Are you with me?
They couldn't say it's because of the frustration of driving on the highway. They could not say, Eve couldn't say, my mother-in-law just bugs me, because she had no mother-in-law. Are you with me? Adam could not say, I got this from my father. He could not blame anybody for how he thought, because he was made perfect.
Yeah. Who had been cast out? Who had been cast out? Man found himself in trouble. Man, who had been made perfect, ends up cast out in Genesis chapter 3, out of the perfect garden of Eden. Man was made in the image of God. He resembled the character of God. So how did we end up in this mess? We are told that the rebellious angel Lucifer, now I'll address men all the time, the rebellious angel Lucifer, who had been cast out of heaven, came to the garden of Eden. When God made man, he placed him in Eden as his home. Came to the Garden of Eden. But when Lucifer came to the Garden of Eden, how did he come? He came in a serpent costume. And this is how the devil works. He never confronts you as Satan. So the storybooks we get is of the devil with two horns and a pitchfork and a long tail.
No. That's not him.
But my friend, when the devil appears, he's going to appear looking like a good friend. Mm-hmm. You come to church and the devil is in church, and if you're not careful, he's on the pulpit.
Mm. Well,
Lucifer had been cast out of heaven and he came to the Garden of Eden. In costume. And the woman had been told by God, both the man and the woman were told by God, avoid that tree. Don't eat of it.
But we read in Genesis chapter 3 that something very different happened. Are you there? Genesis chapter 3 verse 1, the Bible says what? Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, what did he say? Did God really tell you not to eat of the trees of the garden? This is how Satan works.
Satan knows what God has said. But if he can get you to wonder if you really know what God has said, he's got you where he wants you. Because the moment you begin to second guess the content of divine revelation, you are on the devil's ground.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. So what's going on? Conversation is taking place between the serpent and the woman, true? Yeah. Now, back in the island, I used to observe this quite regularly. You'd see a young lady, and she's an upright-looking young lady, good moral rectitude, good reputation, and you see a young man. He's on the idler's corner, and all day long he's kneading his spams. You know what I'm talking about? Kneading his spams. He's rolling his marijuana spliff, and he's up to no good. And you see careless girls go by, and he doesn't blink an eye, because that's not what he's interested in. But he sees a young lady go by, and she walks with dignity, and he smiles to himself, and he says, that one. And he has a little conference with his friends. He says, watch me. So she's coming back the next direction on her way home.
does he do? He throws a word out.
Nice lady. Pretty girl. But she knows better than to talk to him. So she holds her head even straighter. And she strides with purpose away from the scene. And he rubs his hand with glee. And he says, tomorrow is another day. He smiles with delight because he sees what he's after.
Come a few days later, and this young man has devised a new strategy. Now he no longer just stands in the corner and throws a word. As she's coming along, he steps out and he steps up beside her. And he begins to try to engage her. But as long as she says nothing, he has nowhere going. But the moment he says something that she responds to, that moment, you can see he wanted to dance with his feet. He says, I got her now. Eve responded to the devil's lie. Eve decided to defend God. The devil said, hath God said that you should not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden. She's defending God's reputation. God was not as mean as you say he is. He says we can eat of the fruit of every tree of the garden. But the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, so she begins to explain to the devil. Let me tell you something, you can't give the devil a Bible study. When you come across someone who has no interest in doing what God says, you cannot allow such a one to take over your space. Are you with me this evening? There is a difference. And so, the woman is explaining, and she says, of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. So now she is explaining, God herself is in trouble, because she said more than God said. God said, don't eat of it. Now she says, God said, don't touch it. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. What is the serpent saying? The serpent saying what the Mormons teach today. What do the Mormons teach? The Mormons say what God now is. What man now is, God once was. Let me say it again. What man now is, God once was. What God now is, man soon shall be. The Mormons say that you are on your way to becoming God. The devil taught that lie originally, so now you know where it came from. Because what the devil was saying to the woman was, the reason God doesn't want you to eat from the tree is that God knows that if you eat from it, you will be like God. God ate from the tree and he became what he is. And because God is selfish and does not want you to have the same benefits that he had, he is telling you, stay away from that tree. So we have philosophers in our world today. We have them loose on our college campuses. And they're telling our young people that at Eden there was not a fall. You see, they say that the devil told the truth and God told a lie. And so there is a famous book walking our campuses called Up from Eden. That at Eden, man became sophisticated because he was naked before and he didn't even know he was naked. But after he ate from the tree of wisdom, he suddenly found out he was naked. Now tell me something. If all that your wisdom can determine for you is that you don't have on clothes, doesn't seem to me that you get much of an upgrade. Bible says, and the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise. She took up the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave unto her husband with her, and he ate. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Genesis 3, 1 to 7 tells me about man's dalliance with the devil. Man had a conversation with Satan. And the result of this conversation was immediately seen. Because whereas before man was enjoying the peace and the joy of Eden, before man had the conversation with Satan, everything was beautiful. But let's talk about the results of having a conversation with the devil. What happened? First, he lost his clothes. He finds out that he's what? Naked. Second, what does he get? Oh, call him on. What does he get? What next? What next?
Division
in the family. When God comes and asks them what's going on, Adam says, God, when I was here all by myself, everything was all right. Until you showed up with this thing called a woman. And she gave me up the tree. All I did was eat. So God, it wasn't me. Division in the family. Shirking of responsibility. Adam. It wasn't me. You know, there's a song in Jamaica that came out of Genesis 3:15. And I can't tell you all the details of the song. But what the artist would say, he said, I was caught on camera.
It wasn't me.
But I just kept my story going. It wasn't me. But the Bible says, lying lips are an abomination unto the Lord, but they that deal truly are his delight. Are you with me? You can deny your responsibility all you want. God knows the details of our actions, and he'll hold us responsible. The accusatory spirits died in Eden. One started accusing the other. Then the snake, innocent bystander, got a downgrade. The Bible says, when God handed down sentences, that the snake was told, on your belly you shall go, for dust you shall eat. You're going to eat dust from now on. You're going to slither on your belly, which suggests that before that the snake was not on its belly. Are you with me? Let's keep moving. Children were to be born in pain. What happened to the woman? Bible says, in pain shall you bring forth children. Then, followers of Satan were inserted into the world, because we're told there will be enmity between you and the woman, between your seed, between the seed of the snake and the seed of the woman. So followers of Satan came into the world. There was war between the followers of Satan and the followers of God. Animosity in the world. One was placed to rule over the other. The woman was told, your desire shall be unto your husband, and he will rule over you. The ground was cursed. Before that, it just naturally gave of its bounties. But now Adam was going to have to toil. Sorrow and sadness would characterize life. You want to know where all this trouble came from? This struggle never came from the design of God. It came from the choice of man. Are you with me this evening? Because when man chose to disobey God, things started to go awry. The Bible says the earth would now bring forth what? Thorns and thistles. Weeds would come out of the ground. Thorns. The roses, you used to be able to retrieve your rose without the risk of being pricked. But now life's joys would be accompanied by sorrow. That was the result of humanity's choice. Ah, you'll have to labor hard to get your bread.
And these days, mothers can't even find their children, and children can't find their parents, because it now takes two parents to make one loaf. It seems that as time has gone on, it's getting harder and harder to make the bread. And then God says, look here, ultimately, you're going to die.
For dust you are, and unto dust you shall return. When God says, you shall die, what God was saying, before this, you were made to live forever. And that's the reason why I believe that when you examine the human brain, 10% of it is neurons, 90% of it we don't even know what it was designed for, because the things that God had envisioned for man, the grand glories that were built into our destiny, we have been cut off from them, disconnected. When man sinned, he was plugged out. Oh, my friends, not just plugged out, but he was foreclosed on. The first man to be foreclosed on in history was Adam.
Yeah. Yeah.
The moment Adam disobeyed God, he lost his house. He lost his house, he lost his kingdom, he lost his inheritance, and he had nothing to give his children but sorrow. Oh, my friends, angels were the bailiffs. His access to the tree of life, which kept him plugged into the life of God, was revoked. Adam's gold card didn't open any more doors. Are you with me? Oh, when Adam tried to draw on the funds of life, the account said bankrupt. Adam's fingerprint no longer granted access. He was a stranger to where he used to live. Now he went out as a wanderer in the earth. All of Adam's descendants lost access in Adam. All of Adam's descendants found themselves in problems because of Adam's choice. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Will you come there with me? Romans 5 and verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world, and what? Death by sin, and so what? Death passed upon all men, for what? For that all have sinned. The loneliness in your heart is because of sin. Did you hear what I said to you? The sorrow you feel is because of sin. The pain you feel is because of sin. The loneliness you feel is because of sin. We have been disconnected from our destiny, disjointed from our inheritance. We have been foreclosed on. Man was now a battery running out of time, with no charging station. Indeed, the prophet Isaiah would tell us about the human situation. Come there with me, Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah 59 and verse 2. What does Isaiah say? Isaiah 59 verse 2. What does it say? But your iniquities have separated between who? Between you and your God. And your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear you. Sin separates from God. And when you try to call heaven and you're living a sinful life, if you're not calling heaven with a desire to separate from sin, if you're calling heaven with the iniquity in your heart, if you're calling heaven in the midst of riotous living, all you're going to get is a busy signal. Isaiah says, your iniquities are separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear you. Then Isaiah begins to talk about the situation. He says, for your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Oh, come on now, let's see ourselves in the stretch. Your lips have spoken lies. Is there anybody here who has not lied? Silent about, I was speaking about a Bible class a few months ago, and Matthew will bear me witness. Bible class, I had a man come here, sit down on a red chair, and look me in the face, and the shadow of you were there, and said, I have not sinned. So I had to tell him, I said, brother, if you were sinless before, you just sinned. Because the Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short. Are you with me? For your iniquities are separated between you and your God. The Bible says, the situation is so bad, none calleth for justice, nor any pleadeth for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. Their webs shall not become garments, neither shall they cover themselves with their works. Their works are works of iniquity, and the act of violence is in their hands. Man left to himself just multiplies evil. Are you with me this evening? The Bible says in verse 7, their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed innocent blood. The way of peace, verse 8, they have not known, and there is no judgment in their goings. They have made them crooked paths. Whosoever goeth therein shall not know peace. The reason there is so much trouble in the world is the people who are governing the world have no relationship with God. The way of peace they have not known. Therefore is judgment far from us. Verse 9. Neither doth justice overtake us. We wait for light, but behold obscurity. For brightness, but we walk in darkness. It seemed to me that the longer we live in a life of sin, the darker the picture becomes. Yeah. Romans chapter 5 and verse 14. Paul would say, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. Death reigned. When God made man, he says, you, Adam, have dominion. Reign over the earth. But when man sinned, death started to rule. Can you imagine the picture? I showed you the other night the earth in the shape of a skull. Death has the inhabitants of earth as its prisoner. Death is the jailer that runs the record and the history of time. Death has become our jailer. You're asking me, Pastor, why would you say death has become the jailer? And I ask you to come with me to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 5. Let me show you that death is the jailer. Genesis chapter 5. Death is running the ward. Bible tells me this is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female he created he them and blessed them. And God called their name Adam in the day when they were created. And then the Bible says what? Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in his own likeness. Stop. When God made man in whose likeness? In his likeness. But when Adam got a son, Adam's son was made in whose likeness? Adam's likeness. We have lost our connection with God. Disconnected. Now death rules over us. Keep moving. Call his name Seth. The name Seth actually means replacement, substitute. Seth was to be the one to replace the son that Cain had killed. Cain killed Abel, and Seth was the replacement. And the days of Adam, after he had begotten Seth, were 800 years. And he begot sons and daughters. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years. And what does it say? He died. Then the Bible says what? Verse 6, Seth lived 105 years And then it tells us about his sons and his daughters. And at the end of verse 8, what does it say? And he... Oh, my friends, we keep on going. Verse 12, pick up Canaan. And Canaan lived 70 years and begot Mahalalel. And Canaan lived after he begot Mahalalel 840 years. And then it tells us a little bit more about him. But come to verse 14, and it says, and what? All the days of Canaan were 910 years, and what? And he died. I said, death is the jailer. Oh, my friends, come down to verse 25, and Methuselah. When you want to say something is old, you say it's old as Methuselah, right? And Methuselah lived 187 years and begat Lamech. And Methuselah lived after he begat Lamech 782 years and begat sons and daughters. And then it says what? All the days of Methuselah were what? 900 and what? 69 years. And what happened to him? Death folds its hand, and it stands as the boss. Death's shadow is draped over human history because we've been separated from the tree of life. We've been separated, disconnected. Sin is the cause. But Pastor, what is sin? Sin, simply put, is disobeying God. No matter how you go about that disobedience, sin is disobedience. Let me say this very simply. There are many individuals tonight who have been deceived because we think that there are black sins and white sins. You know, there are dangerous sins and there are non-dangerous sins. You understand? There are some sins that will affect you, and there are some sins that, you know, it's really not me. So, we talk about little sins and big sins. But I've told you here before that there is no little sin, because there is no little God to sin against. Because the offense is measured in relationship to whom it is against. You see, depending on who you have offended, you feel a certain way, right? Well, my friend, when you realize that you have offended the mighty God, the everlasting, the holy, the righteous, when you realize that you have sinned against the Creator of heaven and earth, there is nothing small about it. Things that you would probably do in the presence of a friend from down the road, you wouldn't do in the presence of the president, because you would think it is very much out of place. True? Well, my friend, ring the order up and try to rehearse your action. And watch the holy eyes of God looking upon you. And ask yourself, have I conducted myself well? So, sin is disobedience. And talk about small sin. All Adam and Eve did were eat a fruit. What's the eat a fruit God's doing? I mean, you mean all this mess over a stupid tree? That's how people process it. But the issue is not the tree. The issue is God says don't. And God's no does not mean maybe. When God says don't, he means don't. Now, the theologians like to get into words. And sometimes they get into words and it gets real confusing. But in the Bible talks about transgression. It talks about blasphemy. And it talks about iniquity. Let me see if I can translate those three words for you.
expression is missing the mark.
Are you following me?
Sinning without intending to sin. Not deliberately setting out to sin. Is that clear? All right. Iniquity is knowing what is right and deliberately doing what is wrong and continuing to do it. That is iniquity.
And to live an iniquitous life will ultimately result in blasphemy. The Bible says, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. If we continue in sin, there remaineth no sacrifice for sin. Are you with me? God can tell you what's wrong and give you the power to do what's right, but if after you know what's wrong, you insist on doing what's wrong, if you know what's right and you insist on doing what's wrong, if you decide, I'm going to keep on doing what I'm doing because this is what I want to do, I enjoy what I'm doing, and I'm not going to stop. My friend, that's iniquity. And it will destroy you.
Friends, come with me to the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Let's examine this matter a little bit more closely. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 22. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 22. 1 Corinthians 15, 22. What does the Bible say? For as in Adam, all men die. In Adam, all men die. I'm going to hold on to the last portion of that text for just a moment. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23, what does the Bible say? Romans 3, verse 23, what does the Bible say? For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, there are people who like to tell me all the time, Pastor, I'm a good person. I'm a good person. But the Bible, the assessment of God, the word from heaven is, there is none that doeth good. No, not one. They are all turned away backward. Your righteousness before me is as filthy rags. Let me tell you what that means. It means that I cannot go out by myself and do enough good works to purchase a right to the tree of life. You see, Adam was foreclosed on because he had no currency in his account sufficient to pay for the debt he had engendered against God. Because when man sinned, he had transgressed against absolute holiness. And for you to pay your debt, you have to be able to produce absolute holiness. So I'm going to ask you, can anybody here stand up and testify? I have produced absolute holiness. I have produced absolute holiness. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. So, we've talked about sin conceptually. We've talked about sin as transgression, missing the mark, hamartia. We've talked about sin as iniquity. We've talked about sin as blasphemy. But let's have a grounding definition for sin. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. What does the Bible say? 1 John 3, verse 4. 1 John 3, verse 4. What does the Bible say? 1 John 3, verse 4. Sin is the transgression of the law of God. Any moment.
that I go contrary to God's instruction, that moment I'm sinning. And you know what happened? We, the Bible says, have all sinned and fallen short. There is nobody here that can pull himself up by his own bootstraps. Americans like to talk about self-reliance. Frank Sinatra sang, "I did it my way." James chapter 1 verse 12. James the apostle wrote, what does he say? Blessed is the man that what? Endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he's tempted, "I am tempted of God." For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. God is not responsible for your failure. You are. Are you with me tonight? Let's keep moving. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. The word there, lust, means desire. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth what? Sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Let me tell you this. Temptation is not sin. So you're walking down the road, young man, and you see that lovely young lady. And she looks like Adam must have felt when he first saw Eve. And you say, "Whoa, man." You don't sin by the first look. Like, wow, that's a beautiful girl. It's the second look that gets you in the trouble. Every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own loss and enticed. That's the second step. Then when loss hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. Because now you are moving from admiring it to wanting to take possession of it. And it's not yours. Sin, my friend, will destroy you. Proverbs chapter 1 verse 10. The wise man Solomon gives some good advice. And I want to give out that advice this evening. What does the wise man Solomon say? If sinners entice thee, do what? Consent thou not. My friend, if you want to live a righteous life, you can't keep sinful company. Now, does that make sense for you? I said, if you want to live a righteous life, you can't keep sinful company. Proverbs chapter 16 verse 25, the Bible says, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the ends thereof are the ways of death. If you hang out on the wrong pathway, you will end up in the wrong place. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Sin has a terrible history. Sin, the record of sin is laid out all there in the scriptures. Genesis chapter 5. We started to see the cataloging of sin's cemetery. And the Bible has a lot of cemetery language in it. The books of Chronicles and Kings are obituaries. Everybody in there died. Just telling you what they did with their lives before they died. Sin is a terrible thing. And if you mess with sin, if you stay with sin, if you treasure sin, it will destroy you. You see, in Genesis chapter 6, sin makes God wipe out an entire generation with a flood. The Bible says, God says, "It repenteth me that I made man." Sin, in Genesis 19, caused God to burn Sodom to ashes. Sin! And the people in Sodom, they were very interesting people. They got so bold in their sin that when angels came to visit them, the men of Sodom proposed angels. That's how bold they got in their sin. And even when they were struck with blindness, the Bible tells me, they continued all night groping for the door. Even if we can't see it, we still want to do it. Sin. Sin messes with your brain.
your own life. Shame. Shame made Saul want to kill David, the best soldier in his army. Saul eventually gave his daughter to David to marry. But even in giving his daughter to David, he tried to kill the guy he's about to give his daughter to marry. Trey says, you know what happened? David. Well, the first daughter he promised David, while David was out fighting, he gave it to another man. And when David came and found out that, you know, the daughter was given to somebody else, David says, but you promised me. And he says, don't mind, I still have other girls. But this daughter, if you want this daughter, you're going to have to go get me 100 Philistine foreskins. David was a brave guy. Saul's plan was that when David went, the Philistines would kill him. But God was on David's side. Are you with me? Oh, my friends, when you have divine favor, the devil can plan for you, but he can't touch you. And so David went, and he killed 200 Philistines. Carried out 200 Philistine foreskins, and Saul couldn't believe it. So David gets the daughter. But Saul still is planning to kill him. Well, you would think that David, being a man who was hunted most of his life, would have been a little bit different about how he approached life. But when David was in power as king, David turns against one of his own soldiers. David sees Uriah's wife, and he says, my mama me! What a lovely lady. And he finds out her husband is not home. Husband is one of the soldiers. He's at war. And David says, bring her to me. And you know, this is the first case of jacket. Anybody, you know, I don't know if I can translate the word jacket for you. But David got the man's wife, got her pregnant. And when he got her pregnant, when she sent the message back that I'm with child, David held his head, said, what am I going to do? And he says, okay, I'm going to send for the soldier, and I'm going to tell him, you know, just have a little leave, take a vacation. And Uriah comes home, and he's such a good soldier. Uriah says, me, I can't go home and sleep with my wife when my buddies are sleeping in the field under the arrow of the enemy. I can't do that. And when David said, go home and don't feel bad about it, it's okay. And then the servants told David he never went home last night. So the next day David said, all right, I'm going to fix his business. And David gave Uriah wine to drink. You know, Uriah was a Hittite. But Uriah was a converted Hittite. When I say he was a converted Hittite, even when David got Uriah drunk, even when he was drunk, Uriah would not act against principle. You're not with me tonight. My friend, it is time for somebody to resist the devil. You're not with me tonight. It is not okay to be friendly with sin. Uriah would not go to his house. Was a man of principle. And so David gave him a letter. Take it back to Job. David arranged and had Uriah murdered. Sin was in David's brain. That's why David behaved that way. Sin. I'm showing you what sin does to you. Then there were some fellows. Now, there's a husband and a wife in the book of Acts. They are famous. Acts chapter 5. They're called Ananias and Sapphira. They were church people. They were people after Jesus had died and rose again. Ananias and Sapphira went to church. And there was a big testimony party going on. Everybody was testifying about giving to God. And Ananias and Sapphira joined the church, but they never really joined God. You're not with me tonight. And Ananias and Sapphira were sitting there in a testimony service, and they said, we want to come back and have big testimony like everybody else. So they went home, and they said, they told the church, we're going to bring a gift. And they sold their land and promised the church to bring the money. And they lied, and God killed them. Because Peter asked the question, is this all the money? And they said, mm-hmm. Yes. And Ananias dropped dead. And then his wife Sapphira came in. She didn't know what happened to her husband. So then Peter asked her the same question, is this all the money? She said, yes. She too dropped dead. The Bible says, lying lips are an abomination unto the Lord, but they that deal truly are his delight. Sin will destroy you.
Sin is not your friend. You see, my friends, sin is a disease on the brain that makes men do stupid things. And that's why Facebook has 56 categories for gender. Because sin is in operation in this society. That's why this administration, running this government in this country, is trying to take away educational funds from schools because they won't make boys use girls' bathrooms. Sin! Sin makes us not even able to identify ourselves. Sin warps the basic thinking process. Ah, my friends, Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 13 tells me about sin's impact on the mind. Come here with me, Jeremiah 6 and verse 13. And I'm not going to go on forever, I'm going to close. But we got to get this one right. Jeremiah 6 verse 13, what does the Bible say? For from the least of them, even unto the greatest of them, everyone is given to what? Oh, you're not there yet. Everyone is given to covetousness. From the prophet unto the priest, everyone dealeth falsely. They have healed also the hurt of the daughter of my people, slightly saying what? Peace, peace, when there is no peace. Were they ashamed when they committed abomination? Nay, they were not at all ashamed. Neither could they, are you there?
Blush.
Neither could they blush. Therefore, they shall fall among them that fall. At the time that I visit them, they shall be cast down, saith the Lord. What's going on here? Jeremiah says, they don't even know how to blush. That means that they've become so comfortable with sin that it doesn't bother them. Anybody know what I'm talking about? If you get comfortable with sin, you will sin and it won't even bother you.
So I spoke to a young lady last week, and she told me, she said, Pastor, I know it's wrong. I know God says I shouldn't, but I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to go do what I plan to do, and when I come back, I will pray and ask God to forgive me.
Sin is ruining the lives of people all around us. Now the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Death in America is a $15 billion a year industry. $15 billion. That includes funeral homes, crematoriums, and cemeteries, but excludes related costs such as headstones and crypts. It is expensive to die in the United States. The average cost of a funeral is $7,323, according to the National Funeral Directors Association. The addition of flowers and a burial plot raises that number closer to 9,000. Almost 2.5 million people died in the United States in 2008. And 1.8 million of these bodies were placed into coffins that were sold. 1.8 million. I'm going somewhere. My friends, the mystery that confronts us is this expanse that God has created. He layered man in such a way that it seemed God had a plan to be connected with man forever. But man has found himself in a situation where he's dying right, left, and center. Everywhere you turn is sorrow. Everywhere you turn is disappointment. Everywhere you turn is death. But I must quickly assert that any improvement of man that gives him only greater capacity to dominate the society is a distortion of God's plan. I must lift up before you the real word from heaven. For God does declare that what man needs is a system upgrade. For the Bible says, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And there is a conflict against that eternal life. You have
to make a decision how you're going to live. The world around us is striving to destroy the very eternal life God plans to offer you. Destroy your capacity to receive it. So, I checked. And my analysis says that the last Super Bowl, last year, industry spent $4.5 million to get 30 seconds of Super Bowl time. $4.5 million. Now, people say all the time, they say, you know, Pastor, I watch television, but it doesn't affect me. But I'm here to say to you tonight that if you are plugged in to the entertainment of this world instead of being plugged into the Word of God, you're going to find out that you are connected in the wrong place and disconnected from the right place. And as long as your daily meal is from this world and not from heaven, you're going to find out that the problem of sin in your life can't get fixed. So people tell me it doesn't matter what I watch, because I watch murder, but it doesn't make me a murderer. I watch thievery, but it doesn't make me a thief. I watch adultery, but it doesn't make me an adulterer. I watch fornication, but it does not make me a fornicator. But I must tell you that by beholding, you become changed. Amen. So back in the early days, they would spend $40,000 for 30 seconds. Today, business spends $4.5 million for 30 seconds. Why do you think they're spending so much money for those 30 seconds? Because they know that when they place an ad, people are getting up, drinking sodas, people are getting up, eating their meals, people are doing all sorts of things. But industry spends $4.5 million for a chance to put something in your head for 30 seconds. Because they know that once you have watched that ad, even if you don't buy it today, you'll buy it tomorrow. My friend, if you want victory over sin, you are going to have to stop watching the devil's ad and look at Jesus. Amen. The power to victory is in God's word. Amen. The problem with sin is in your mind. And here is the message. Jesus said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Amen. John 1 verse 12, I'm going to stop. The Bible says there is a solution. God has sent a solution. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. When Adam was foreclosed on, he walked away from his connection. He lost his power. He lost his possession. He lost his inheritance. And his children were born under the threat of death. But tonight I tell you the truth. Though we were born disconnected, though we were born dispossessed, though we were born disinherited, though we were born disconnected, disenfranchised, though we have been born under the threat of death in the valley of fear, we can leave here this night with hope, with strength, with a future, with an inheritance, if we would open the door to Jesus.
Amen.
The devil tricked Eve looking like a snake. And today he tricks the world looking like a television screen. And I am telling you this evening, if you want joy, you have got to turn your back on the devil's advertisement.
Yes.
Because the pathway to satisfaction is not in looking at the world. It is in looking at Jesus.
Yes.
For as many as received him, to them gave him power. The reason your life feels so straining, so sorrowful, so painful, the reason your life feels so sad is because you are trying to live without power. Try making your bulb shine without plugging it in. And you will find out what it is like living disconnected from God. You are living without power.
And that's why Jesus says, as many as received him, to them gave he power. Tonight, if you are here, and you want to say, Pastor, I realize that my life has been a life without power. My life has been like that man on that bridge, standing up looking, wondering, where am I going? Because there is nowhere else to go. I am here to say to you, when you reach the point where you realize there is nowhere else to go, and you don't have to wait till you reach there. It is time for you to look up, because your solution is not down here. Your solution is up there. There the Creator who made you is up there, signaling, and he's saying, hold up your eyes and look at me, open up your heart, and I will give you power. I reconnect you, I will realign you, I will reposition you, I will reconnect you, and I will recommission you. You can be redeemed. Amen. It is not all lost, the devil says it is, but Jesus says there is hope. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You can get it all. You can have it all. But you've got to get it through Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father except he come through me. I have exceeded 9 o'clock. I've transgressed against time. I ask you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, even now this moment, as we pray, there are individuals seated here who need to be reconnected to the divine life. We're all born disconnected. Our batteries are running down. And if we don't accept Jesus, we will die in a world of sin with no hope of eternal life. This misery is all we'll ever know. But I know, Lord, that you have a bigger, a greater, a much more magnificent plan for us. That 90% of grandiose cells was not just there because God didn't have anything better to do. I believe you have for us a glorious future. And there's a message even in the human body that God has an eternity that he's offering. You have said in your word, I have placed eternity in your heart. But we keep running out of time. Even now tonight, as we run out of time in this service, I ask of you that you will give to someone the courage, when we shall have concluded this moment, to raise up their hand and say, Lord, I choose to live not as one who shall die forever, but as one who through Christ shall live forever. I ask you, Lord, to plug me into Jesus. And even now, Lord Jesus, for those who are here and who don't even understand their need of Jesus, brighten their understanding to conviction of their need, that we may leave here tonight. We may leave here with possession of earth's greatest treasure, Jesus, the Christ of the ages, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You're here tonight, and it is your desire in your heart. Jesus, I know I need you. I know I need you. I came in disconnected, but I want to leave here. I want to leave with a resolve that I will not live my life disconnected. I resolve to live the rest of my life plugged into Jesus. You're here tonight, and you want to say, this is my desire. I want to be plugged into Jesus. Won't you just raise that hand where you are? I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. Won't you just raise that hand? I see your hand, sister. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. I see your hand, my son. I see your hand. I see your hand, my brother. Keep those hands up. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. Is there somebody else who wants to live their life plugged into Jesus? I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. Separated from him, I have no life. Plugged into him, I have life eternal. The Bible says that this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. You are here tonight, and you want to say, I resolve to live my life plugged in to Jesus. You have raised your hand.
You have raised your hand. You have raised your hand. I'm going to ask you, won't you just stand with me? Stand with me. Follow those hands and stand with me. Follow those hands and stand with me. You're standing. Keep on standing. Come. Follow those hands and stand with me. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. I want to live my life plugged into Jesus. Whatever that means for you, the ushers are giving you a card. They're asking you to record a decision as to what that means to you. And I'm going to ask you to write that down as we sing the final song. Can the singers come forward? I've heard of a land on the faraway shack. That's the beautiful home of the soul, built by Jesus on high, where we never shall die. Tis a land where we shall never grow old. Doesn't matter how many times you've made a decision for Christ before. Write something down tonight.
Testimony of the greatness of God. And that 10% of your brain that is made of neural cells carry messages that man can analyze is but a reminder that 90% of what you were designed to do is still beyond where you have lived and reached. God's plan for your life is bigger than your problem. It's bigger than your achievement. It's bigger than you can ever hope or dream of. But the only way you're going to ever realize it is if you get plugged into Jesus. Born disconnected, please don't die disconnected. I challenge you, get plugged in to Jesus. Now, oh Father, as we go, please let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Tomorrow night, we start at 7 p.m. sharp, and I promise you, I'll send you out at least 5 minutes early. God is going to do a special thing for you, but you need to get plugged in.